Okay. Good afternoon, everyone, and thanks for coming. I know we are going to have lunch in about 1 hour, so I'm not going to delay you because I know that many of you are dreaming about it already. But instead, I will try to give you some delicious appetizers in the form of Agile practices. And I'm happy to see a lot of friends here from the previous Gen Beyond conferences. And for those who don't know me, my name is Oleg Nesterov. I'm CEO of a web development and mobile development company in Ukraine. We have 26 developers, project managers, quality assurance engineers. We specialize in developing custom applications, mostly using Joomla, Nuku, Wii, and Symfony frameworks. And we have a lot of experience with building custom Joomla extensions or sets of extensions that build the system for our clients. And we also helped extension providers such as Dioscore Design and Joom United to build their best-selling components. So what are we going to talk about today? The things I'm going to talk can help you to boost your client collaboration, your software quality, and delivery. Most of the things suit teams rather than solo developers. But some of them can be used for individual work. My goal is not to explain you in details every single engineering practice, but rather to draw you the entire workflow that you can use to build your project development methodology or to enhance existing one. So what is Agile and engineering practices? There are a lot of definitions of Agile that you can find on the internet, and the many descriptions, many explanations. For me personally, Agile is an ability to respond to changes. To changes in your team, in your clients' minds, in your projects. The same is for Agile. There are a lot of definitions of what is practice. For me, it's everything that helps you build high-quality software, and that's the main thing. All the tools that you can use, and besides the obvious benefits of building high-quality and stable software, there are also two more to mention. Using these practices, you can reduce the cost of changes and maintenance, and I think that's especially important for Joomla extension providers. I think that sometimes much time is spent on the maintenance phase than on the development one. So let's say we've got a project and we have a development team which consists of three developers, one quality assurance developer, and we have one development server, one production, and we are using Git. Here is how we can present our development workflow. So what is the first thing you would do when you get a project? I would choose the project development methodology and testing methodology. Could you please put your hands up, those of you who heard about Scrum? Fantastic. And now those of you who used Scrum for their projects. Okay, so let me tell my experience with Scrum. We tried Scrum 1 year ago for my company. Before that, we were using old good waterfall, and we actually didn't know that the name for this methodology was waterfall. We thought that was natural to do projects like this. You first write the specification, and you don't start the development until you complete your specification. Then you do, for example, design. You don't start development until you finish design. Then you do development, like for 5 months, and only then you start testing. And this example is from the real life. We've got a project. We had only a brief, not even real specification. We did estimation without design, without knowing all the details. We said that this project would take 3 months. And then we did not collaborate with the client. We did not tell that the scenes that they sent in their design is completely different from what we thought. That was a big, big Joomla extension, very custom extension that they could not find on JET. So what happened? So after 3 months, that client came and was really excited to see his project. We had something on every page, but nothing in general. What happened next? We spent 4 more months fixing bugs and doing changes which the client thought should have been included into this product. So that was my experience. And then we thought that we did everything wrong in project management, in project development, because we had a lot of bugs and like thousands of bugs or something. So we tried to use a different approach. Again, there are many definitions of Scrum, and you can read them on the internet. This is what my company feels about Scrum. So for project managers, it gives them a feeling that they have a control of their project. And for team, it's a great team building tool. Team feels like they're doing the project as one. And for the client, they think that that we are probably doing something that they need. So it's about collaboration with your client and collaboration inside your team. Scrum has three roles, three ceremonies, and three artifacts. So you have roles, product owner. If you want to do Scrum, you need your client. Product owner is your client or client representative. You need someone who says what features should be done when. And that's really hard to do Scrum without product owner. We have projects that we're doing without product owner. When the client doesn't care about the project methodology, they want a fixed budget and they want the deadline. And that's it. In these cases, you can use the role called so-called the proxy product owner. So this can be your project lead, your project manager, or your technical lead, someone from your team that would act as a product owner, but he still needs to talk to your client. Then you have a Scrum Master. That's a person who manages your entire Scrum process. And many beginners mix the role of project manager and Scrum Master. Scrum Master is not a project manager. You can have a project manager who is doing Scrum, but he needs to change his head. So this is about roles and not about mixing roles. And then you have team. So this is a typical diagram about Scrum. You have your product or project. You break down your project into small stories, features, and you form your product backlog with these features. Then you decide what you're going to do during the closest iteration. And so this iteration is called sprint. So then you form your sprint backlog, you sit together with your client, you set the priorities, and then you do this iteration. And there is one goal here, to get a working software at the end of every iteration. That is the main goal of Scrum. Different teams choose different iteration lengths. That depends on your project, on your client demands. There is a thought that clients like short iterations and developers like long iteration. Clients like short iteration because they get a working product at the end, and developers don't like short iterations because they need to test, they need to fix, they need to deploy, to fix again, and to deploy again. So that takes a lot of unnecessary time for them, as they think. But you should not try Scrum for every project. That's not a panacea. All people are talking about Scrum these days. But you should always think whether this could work with your client and with your project. It's probably not the best idea to start using Scrum when you have a big ongoing project, because you are changing your project methodology, and that will cause a lot of issues, and you will waste a lot of time. We did this mistake at my company. We tried to change to Scrum when we had projects that were not finished, and of course that put us back, and we missed a lot of deadlines. However, Scrum is only a project management, a project development approach. It doesn't say anything about quality of your software. So you can meet deadlines, you can have good plans, you can have good collaboration with your clients, but you can get badly developed software when you meet the deadline. And this is called a flexit Scrum. So my goal is to show you how you can build high quality software using Scrum. Testing. Have you been in this situation? That's actually me sitting there. When my developers come to me and say that everything was that's left is just to fix bugs and deploy. That's what happens when you don't have testing, when you don't have testing workflow, and that will happen. Here is another typical situation. You do just a development. Yes, your developers or you can test, but you don't test the entire system. You don't test integrations. You don't have test scripts that you can automate. So you finished development, then you start testing, you find the bug, you fix it, you find two more bugs, you fix them, you find four more bugs. And this process is going on. So nowadays we should accept that quality assurance as a separate department is dead. We shouldn't do quality assurance as a separate phase project. And you shouldn't hire an outside company to make quality assurance for you after the project is finished. Yes, this could work for some projects, of course. But for the most, no. So you can say that testing and coding is one process. Or you can say that development is testing plus coding. But there is one good question, what to test? There are a lot of different test approaches, and you can use different tools. This is a typical pyramid of the test process. So you mainly test units, which is called unit testing, and I hope many of you know what this is. You can test integration, and you can test your interface. And the main mistake that many people do when they start testing as they do development, that's they start testing from the interface. And this is what we did as well. People tend to start write those tests for the interfaces or do a lot of manual testing. That's not good. First of all, your UI tests are slow because they use browser. If you know tool called Selenium for automated tests, it just clicks and goes to pages like your real user, and that takes time. Then every little change to your design would lead to many changes to your tests. And the last one, you can't test your car, like test bolts, test connections, just by sitting there. You need to check something from the core part. So that's why the most test cases you should have should be for unit tests. Then you can do integration testing to check how your units, classes, or different parts of the system work together. And then you can do manual testing, just clicking links and checking the pages in the browser. Okay, so that's what you do before you start the project. You choose a project development methodology and testing methodology. And since we have a dedicated quality assurance guy to work on our extension, he can work on the testing approach. He can prepare a test strategy, chooses what software we are going to use to help us testing. By the way, I forgot to say that we are going to make the next CCK killer extension for Joomla. So in Scrum, there is a term called Sprint Zero. That's what you do together specification, because we don't know yet what this project would be. You get a specification and you set up some routines like servers, like Git repositories. So the first thing we should do is that we should define our stories, features, or to write the specification. And we are going to write the specification in terms of user stories. And we are going to write these stories in terms of business. This is where we connect business to your development team. Here is a proposed template for writing descriptions, specifications for your features or stories. Features and stories are a bit different, but for simplicity, let's say that they are the same. So I, as a role, want some feature so that I can get some benefit, some business value, outcome from this. And you see, there is nothing about design, fields, data, databases. This is about business value. Why are we building software? We are building software to help businesses. That is the main goal. We're not building it to get paid or to pay salaries or to be happy just by coding. We are building software to help business to succeed in their field. So knowing this helps us to define the business value of each single feature. So instead of writing a full specification for 200 pages with a table of contents and all those things, we will try to work very close to the business and define the most valuable features for them. But how do we know that the functionality that that was developed for this feature satisfies us completely? That we can do using acceptance criteria. If the acceptance criteria is passed, that means that our feature is doing what our business needs. There is a language called Gherkin, and here is a proposed template for writing your acceptance criteria. So it's simple three words: given, when, then. Given, you give some initial context. When means when you are doing something as a customer, and then you are describing what you want to achieve or what you expected from this. So we can have one one story and many acceptance criteria for this story. Yes?
Can you do an example of both?
Yeah, yeah, later.
Okay.
And that is something that is called behavior-driven development. If we look closer to the story and its acceptance criteria, we can see that we're actually describing not, or we're not testing that this value is equal to this value. We are explaining the behavior of this system. And that is important to your business. So like you see, again, there is nothing in acceptance criteria about fields, about data. So you're not writing acceptance criteria like I fill five fields with these values and then I click submit. That doesn't matter for your business at this stage. And with the behavior-driven development, BDD, you should automate your acceptance criteria. Acceptance criteria is a set of acceptance test scenarios. So later I will show you how to do this. Okay, so we defined our stories, features of our product. I should mention that sometimes just having user stories is not enough. Sometimes you really need specification, or at least specification for some features, or better or bigger explanation of each feature. So this is not a panacea, again. You should decide it, but you can try different ways, and then you find a balance between writing user stories and between writing old, good, long specification. So we have user stories. What we are doing next, we need to form our backlog. Backlog is our list of features, all features for this project. Let's say we have five features for this CCK killer extension for the first release. This is a list of articles, a list of categories, filtering both for categories and articles, and form to add categories in articles. Very simple. So, example. The title of your story should be act, not definition. Because, let's read, content manager filters articles. That means that until we develop this feature, the content manager doesn't have an ability to filter articles. So again, we are coming to the business value. So user stories should, the titles of user stories should be written as actions, not definitions. And then you can see how we can write a user story that will cover the filtering of articles in the Joomla backend, for example. And here is a sample test scenario with given when then approach. Okay? Okay, so now we have features, at least for the first release. What we're going to do next? We're going to estimate these features. And now we're coming to something called planning procure. And this is those packs that I gave you at the beginning of this session. Let's start with two simple rules. Who should estimate your features? I say that your entire team, each member of your team should make estimations. In Scrum, you don't divide features by developers. You don't assign developers at the beginning. You don't know who is going to work on this or that feature. That is decided during daily stand-ups meetings. So that means that all developers should estimate. And you know, people get sick, people quit. And some people are cute. That means that your team should be flexible enough to cover this loss. Yes, and if you have quality assurance people, they also should estimate your features. You can ask how you can estimate a development and testing time at as one go. This we can see later. And the second rule is that your product owner, your client, can change estimates. He or she cannot say, like, you know, guys, 5 days, that's a lot. Let's do it for 1 day. He cannot say this. But at the same time, he can say this if you reduce the scope of this feature. So the only way for product owner to influence the estimation is to change the scope. So here is the cost that you can have. This is my gift to you, and I hope that they will help you to estimate more efficiently. Some people say that these are numbers of Fibonacci, the famous mathematics, so that the next number is sum of the previous two ones. But as you can see, for 40 and 100, that doesn't work. So what are these numbers? This can be actually anything. This can be your hours, this can be your days, and this can be relative points, units. But let's go back a little bit. Why is so hard to estimate? Do we have designers here? Don't kill me after the session. Programming is also a creative process, right? You create your product, and each product is unique. Each feature is unique, and each client is unique. Even though you developed this login module 100 times before for a standard Joomla website, some things can be different. You can have another part of the system that could change this behavior. So the only thing you can say about estimation of this, for example, login module, is that how much or less time this module could take you to develop than the modules that you developed previously, based on your experience. It's like if I ask you to estimate how many steps it would take you to go from this part of the room to that one, staying just over here. You can guess, right? But if I say you can go to the middle of this room and count, and then stop and say me, that's easier, right? You need to have some basics. And so that's why we can try to estimate not in ideal hours or days, but in some relative points. You can still estimate in hours, but that would be for small tasks. Just for technical things like create database, create this model class, whatever. But to understand the feature completely from the beginning, sitting with your client and say the accurate estimation, that's almost impossible. How many of you failed with your estimations? Yes. Because we are bad estimators. We are putting our heart into what we are doing. And we want to do it better, right? You know, when you estimate feature, you probably wouldn't think about making this button more fancy. And then you go into this process and you start doing things, and you see that you got over the estimation. Because we are big optimists as developers. That's true. So what we can do with these planning cards? Again, there are many different ways of doing this. So let's say we're going to estimate in some relative units. In order to do this, we need to define the most understandable story feature from our project. The one that we can say, regardless of the complexity of different connections, of different templates, this feature never took me more than 3 hours. So your entire team should find such a feature, which you can estimate precisely, or to some extent, like for 95%. And this feature you need to estimate in hours, but not those hours that you work. but hours when you don't get interrupted. No coffee, no Facebook, no Twitter, just sitting and coding. And that is also the biggest mistake. When we do estimations as developers, and then we do this in hours or days, we think that we work 8 hours per day, right? But that's not true. And that's why at my company, we base all estimations on 6 hours per day work, not 8 hours. So let's say we found this story, and let it be the list of articles, right? Very simple. But at the same time, this story should not be the simplest one. You can have some more complex story. The main point is that you understand how many hours that will take you to develop. But of course, in most cases, the most understandable is the smallest one. And we just assign some points to this story. Let's say 2. Why 2? Because what we're going to do next is to see how much complex this story, or more complex or less complex than our story list of articles in the Joomla backend, so that we can have stories with 1, 1/2, and 0 estimations, just small things. So what's happening next? You take your client in Skype or in a meeting, you take your team together with developers, Scrum Masters or Scrum Master, and quality assurance guys. And people take those packs. You should have a pack for each person that will be doing these estimations. Product owner, your client, explains the feature. People, your team, can ask questions. When they are ready, they decide about their point. So when you do estimation in some relative points, story points, you shouldn't think in terms of hours. Just forget. You need to clear your mind. What you should think about is this feature more complex or less complex than that feature that I know for sure how much time it will take. Why do you need this planning poker packs, and why do you need to make it so complex? Why you can't just let people say it one by one? That is because you can have people of different level. You can have a junior, senior, and you can have a technical leads with a lot of experience. Of course, the first word in this case would go to the senior developer. And let's say he says, this feature will take 3 hours for me. But for example, you, a junior developer, you just come to this company a few months ago. You don't know the product very well. You don't know the system. You don't know the approaches and PHP also. You don't know that very good. So you think, okay, this senior guy said 5. But for me, it's more like 100. But if I say 100, then people will think that I'm stupid, that I'm junior, and they should fire me. So let's say, okay, not 5, but 13. And then when it comes to doing this development, this feature comes to that junior developer. And this feature takes him 100 story points over 100 days, not 13. And your project managers made plans based on these estimations. They set plans to the clients. So that's why when you do estimations, you do them just by yourself. So you decide, and then all team members put their cards. So what happens next? Let's say now we have one developer that said 2, another one said 5, another one said 8, and now it comes to a quality assurance guy. Since we are estimating the complexity, not the duration, then your quality assurance developers can say, is this feature more or less complex than the previous one that they tested? And in most cases, the feature that takes more time to develop takes more time to test. So let's say your quality assurance guy said 20. So 2, 3, 5, and 20. What happens next? Your Scrum Master, the person who manages your Scrum process, asks 2 people. The one who said the smallest estimation and the other one who said the biggest. Why the first one thinks that it's so easy to do and why the other one thinks that's so hard to do. And we had a good example with tester. We had approximately the same situation when tester said 20. So then you ask why you think that is so complex to test. And then you get something like, but don't you remember, guys, that during the last iteration we changed the JavaScript framework, but we just use it for one, for example, filtering form, and we decided that we will do this later for the next ones. So do you remember how many bugs we got during these changes? And we missed the deadlines. So this is a team work. Your team discusses, and all team members that will be working on this system takes part in these estimations. Then you do another estimation based on new information that you just received. And then you decide what story point will be assigned to what user story. There is a simple formula how to calculate the deadlines based on these things. I can explain it after the session. There are also two special cards, question mark and coffee. Question mark means that you don't give a don't get a clue what's happening. You don't know this feature at all, and you can't estimate. And coffee means that is the seventh hour of estimation, and you are actually tired. So let's have a break. Okay. At this stage, we are forming our backlog, list of all our features. We don't need precise estimations. So most of our user stories would have estimates like 20, 40, or 100. We don't need, because in Scrum, you focus on the next iteration. But it's good to make some plans. And of course, your clients will request you to make a very detailed plan. So you can provide this plan, and you can provide with release planning based on these rough estimations. You don't need to estimate them precisely in hours. Say that this will be done by 12 o'clock tomorrow. That's not required. What's left to do before we move to actual coding is to set up some routines. And here we come to Git for Teams. Here is what approach we use at my company. The default master branch should be always stable. That is the branch that will be deployed to your production. And you don't want your clients to see an unstable solution. For each sprint, for each iteration, let's say for each 2 weeks of development, you made a branch, sprint branch. And this branch is connected to the development server. On this development server, you can have a demo to your clients of new features, and you can run your integration tests. That's called regression testing, when you retest the whole solution to see what could happen when you added a lot of features. And it's good when you have these tests automated, because then this process will kill you. Then for each story that you are working inside one sprint, you make a separate branch. Git was then done for branches. For those of you who came from Sweden, you know what I'm saying. That was awful to do branches and merge them in Sweden. So you can do a lot of branches. Just do branch and merge. That's okay. In each story branch, you run your isolated tests. This can be an automated test, this can be an acceptance test, a unit test, and this can be manual checking by you. So this is how it could work. The benefits. Let's say you are in the middle of delivering some features, so you are working on some sprint. and you have done a few features already. And then all of a sudden your client says, we are making a demo to our customers, so we just need those two new features. What you can actually do, you can merge a few stories to your sprint, or you have this done already. So the thing is to keep your master branches and sprint branches stable. And when you merge your story to the sprint branch, you do testing. What happens if you found bugs? You come, or your quality assurance found bugs. You come to your office next morning, and your quality assurance developer says, hey, you know, Oleg, we found like 20 bugs, but not in your story, but in other parts of the system. That and this was caused by your new change. You put off new features. You actually don't take on new features. What you are doing is you are trying to make the sprint branch stable. And if you need other people to help you, you ask for this help. So this is a team goal to keep your sprint branch stable, because then you can have your master branch stable. Then it comes to sprint planning. That's almost the same as sprint zero, but here you set the priorities, not you, but your product owner set priorities for the next iteration. So if we're talking in terms of business, because we define stories in terms of business, your client chooses what business values should go first. And all the things that I explain now can be easily used when you are an extension development company, because then you don't have client, then you don't have a product owner that you need to convince to use Scrum to take part in your meetings. Then you have your project lead, which who is interested in taking part in this, because you are bringing the same value to your company. So you set priorities. You break up stories, big stories, because when we did backlog planning, we had big stories and we made rough estimations. When we do sprint estimation, we need more precise estimates. So we break stories into smaller ones. At my company, we don't have stories more than 1 or 2 days of development. That is to make this process of Scrum going by itself. If you have big stories, that means that you have, let's say, 5 stories which are in progress. That means that someday they will go to the testing phase. And that will take a lot of time for you and for your testers to test all of them. So you don't know the status. You have, let's say, 7 features in your sprint, and 5 of them are in the development. You don't know the status, whether they are done or not done. You can just guess. So that's why you should break your stories into small pieces, 1 or 2 days of development. And that will also help you to do more efficient Git branching and merging, because then the sprint branch doesn't go too far from your story branch, because you do merging more often. So you do estimates and using the same planning poker approach. And you create tasks for each story. Task is just for you, for developers, for your team. Clients don't see your task. This could be a technical thing, like create a new database, refactor something. These things you can estimate in hours, because that's more clear for you how to do it. And then you create a new branch for your sprint. The cycle of one user story. This is somehow related to Kanban, a different Agile project methodology. And this approach came from Toyota company. So the goal is to get a story and to mark it as done, to reduce the cycle of each your story. Here is the steps that your story can walk while you're developing it. So status new. You create a new branch for this story. And then it comes to the interesting thing called test or behavior-driven development. When you write test first, that is a thing that you should definitely try. If you're not trying it, that will change your mind. That will actually break your mind, because that's a different thinking. That's like coming from SVN to Git. If you're trying to use Git but think in terms of SVN, then you fall down. It's the same with Scrum, with all these practices and with this test-first approach. So what you actually do? You write your tests before you write code. But it's a wrong thought that you should write the whole test and then start to write your code. These things come one by one. You know something about what you're going to develop. You can have some test prototype. Then you write code that satisfies your test. So this practice is called red, green, refactor. You write tests that fail because you don't have code. They are red. You write the minimum amount of code just to satisfy your test. And if yes, then you do refactoring. That allows you, firstly, to think how you're going to implement this feature. And then write your code. So you don't write unnecessary code. You just write code that satisfies your tests. And your tests are based on what your clients need. And if you are talking about acceptance testing, behavior-driven development, these tests are written in business language. So if you are using if you're doing a unit test, then you should definitely try PHP unit. That's standard. And for acceptance testing, there is a tool called Behead. It's written in PHP, and it's written for PHP developers. If you remember those acceptance scenarios in given, when, then format, you still write them in this format, but this tool automates you for them. And you write PHP code for your acceptance testing, like to click this button, go to this page. And Behead integrates a lot of different test frameworks. So you can use Selenium for browser testing. You can use a few other test tool for headless testing. So just to make an HTTP request without JavaScript and without CSS, just to check that all things are on their places. So. And that means that your developers actually can write those automated tests. I know that in many companies, people don't hire and don't want to hire dedicated quality assurance developers, because that's additional cost. So in this case, your developers can write tests. And again, that's a different thinking. Your developers and you can write those automated tests for testing your interface. But if you remember that pyramid that we discussed before, most of your test cases should be unit tests. Don't spend too much time on writing these automated tests, because that's a long process, and that's not a flexible solution. So again, your team collaborates all together. If you have a dedicated quality assurance person, he can help with writing these automated tests for acceptance. He can talk to your client to define these test scenarios when they're discussing. So it happens like this. Your client says what they need, what value they need from this feature. Then your quality assurance developers write scenarios based on what your client needs. And then your developers estimate what time that will take to implement. So it's a teamwork. What we should do when a story is done? When when all the tasks for this story is done? We want a high quality software, right? So we better check the code before we upload it. This practice is called code review. A few suggestions from my company. Again, this should be a team building approach for your company, for your development team. Each developer should do code review. That's a good knowledge sharing process, and it doesn't take you money to set up the learning process in your company. I'm speaking from my experience. So I'm still struggling how to set up this workflow so that we learn new things, we share some parts of code, we don't write the same code two times, especially when we have projects that are completely different and from different clients. But at least inside one team, you can share this experience. So junior developers should also do code review. And for them, that's mostly learning. Yes?
You told me about this estimate. You had to estimate the work for yourself. But what about if you have to review all everything everybody else writes? How do you estimate that in the project? When you talked about the estimate, when you have to estimate the project, you only have to estimate if you have to do it yourself, how much time it would cost? So
yes.
Estimate for the junior developer or the senior, only what you what it costs you. But what if you have to do all the reviews for all the code, all the people?
But you do code review. You don't review time estimates that they did. You just check code.
Yeah, but that costs you time. So how will you calculate it into the project?
Yeah, that is called risk management. When you define how many user stories you will do during this sprint, you should have some risk. That's called velocity. In Scrum terms, velocity is number of features that your team can do during a set period of time. And you can figure out this velocity for the fifth or for the sixth sprint. You can't find it from the beginning. So that's an average value. That's an average number of stories that you can do during sprint with this old techniques, with code review, with different, with stand-ups, meetings, and with estimations for the next sprint. Because when you're working on the current sprint, you should also find some time to estimate the next one. So this is a process. But who should approve code review? Who should say that this feature is done and we can use it in production? At my company, this is done only by senior developers. Because you need to have someone experience. How to do it? There are many tools. Someone can just put his hand up and say, hey guys, I'm finished. Could you please go and check my code? If you're working with distributed teams, you should use pull requests. This is a well-known approach for open source projects when different contributors want to merge their code, but you can use pull requests for your company. We're using Bitbucket because it's a bit cheaper than GitHub. But if you want something for free, there is a software called GitLab. It's like GitHub, but open source, and you can install it behind your firewall. So when a story is done, the developer makes a pull request. Then you do code review, and then we go to the next stage.
Can I ask you why you don't have to move already to GitLab?
why you say use still in Bitbucket? Is there any reason for you?
We just like it. And then you don't need to maintain your own server. Then you need to have a system administrator or someone from your team to update to the newest versions. And we discovered it maybe 1 month ago. So just OK, so when code review is done, you can actually deploy your story and merge it with your sprint branch. So then you can check if this story breaks other stories. And that's called regression testing. And this is where your quality assurance developers can test the system manually. And then you are done. Of course not, because you will get a lot of bugs. So what happens after you finish your sprint? You can do a demo to your client. And again, demo is a team work. In many companies, quality assurance developers do the demo because they've written acceptance criteria. Some interesting point. How do you know that your sprint is done? Your client needs to say. But for your client to say this, they need something to check. And if you remember what we discussed about acceptance criteria, you have these acceptance things already done. You don't need to write them after you finish the product. You just create a document, write all those acceptance criteria for each story, and send to the client so that they can check and put yes marks and then sign. That's what we started to do recently, so that we know that this sprint is done and accepted by the client. When it's done, you can do a retrospective meeting. That's a very cool and powerful thing. That's a meeting where you sit together with your team and think what you can do better next time. That really helps. Each team member can say what he thinks was done wrong and what he would like to see during the next iteration. So you should do this each second week, for example, if you're doing sprints of 2 weeks. So again, just to summarize, when is the story done? When your all tests passed, when you have at least one acceptance test, because then you don't know whether this feature is accepted by the client or not. If you're using some code analyzing and style checkers, then they all should pass, and all critical and major bugs are fixed. And that's for one story. So this is the entire development workflow that we use at my company. You can have different things. And as I said, you should always think about your case. Don't just try to use all of them. And for those of you who are starting with these approaches, I know that's a lot of new information. So my suggestion, start with Agile, start with Scrum, because that is the basis. Then you can easily do efficient branching and code review. That's easy to do. Then you need to break your mind to do test-driven development and acceptance or behavior-driven development. That's all. Thank you. Here is a QR code to a form that you can send me any questions.